As nutty as this topic sounds, there's actually a very good scientific reason why we chose to look at the increasing urge to void urine and why the pain, the perception of pain, and the voluntary control it takes to withhold bladder function impacts cognition. Really, it's a very simple natural laboratory. It was a low-cost, low-budget way of inducing temporarily a increasing transient perception of pain that increases in severity, that isn't associated with any real risk or danger, that we could remove immediately, of course, when necessary, and to study how that increase in pain and pain perception impacts on cognitive functioning. We ran this study about a year ago, beginning about a half an hour after I got off a plane in Melbourne, Australia. And my bladder and brain was one of the participants in this study. A group of us decided to do this low-budget trial to validate our instruments, and we started drinking 250 milliliters of water every 15 minutes. And these are the epochs here. And the top line shows the urge to void that increase, and this is a group-wise increase, so all of us taken together. And it's a pretty reliable increase in the urge to void. This line underneath shows the pain perception associated with that urge. These data depicted on this bar chart show the results from two different tests of ours. The zero line is the baseline for the group. This is where we all started. And the larger the change, the more impairment. And what you see with the white lines, this is the performance from baseline at extreme urge to void our bladders. The gray bars are the level of impairment when you've had 0.05 blood alcohol level. So this is close. In the United States, that is getting close to the legal limit for driving. In Australia, where we ran this study, 0.05 is the legal limit. So this is the legal limit for driving in Australia. So this is after a couple drinks at a bar, and you can see the impairment on the simple identification test, a measure of simple attention, is about the same. And for a working memory task, which is more complex online executive function, the urge to void is even larger. The black line is level of impairment after 24 hours sustained wakefulness. Certainly for simple attentional controls, withholding urine function and that pain associated with it is really interfering with simple attentional controls at exactly the same rate, level of severity as the other two conditions. And for a working memory test, which is arguably very important for many of our daily functions, it's even worse, and significantly so. The primary reason that we chose to run this study, and I'd like to give credit especially to my colleague in Melbourne, Professor Paul Maruff, who really conceived of this from the beginning, was to take a series of tests that we developed, that are new tests, that we hope would be resilient to practice effects if you give the tests over and over again. We need to have a series of cognitive measures, particularly of things like working memory, that people don't just keep getting better at so that the tests become meaningless if you give them over and over again. But it has practical applications. If we could benchmark the intensity of those changes, the severity of those changes, against other real-world problems that people have, such as drinking alcohol and getting behind a wheel of a car, or staying up for 24 hours and then continuing to work, which happens, of course, in many job settings, then we have some way of benchmarking this activity, withholding urine, against these other real-world issues that people face that might impact on cognition. There are regions of the brain, particularly in the posterior portion of the anterior cingulate, which is right in the frontal, middle of the frontal region of the brain, that's important for both management of the perception of pain and with certain aspects of cognition, including working memory. So the fact that there is this link isn't simply there because of psychological reasons you're distracted. There actually is probably a neurologic basis for the relationship as well. So it teaches us something that's practical, that's useful. It helped us to validate tests. but it also helped us to better understand the neurology of bladder control. And so it was interesting for all sorts of reasons. The other neat thing about this study is that it cost pennies. And the fact that you can run a study that informs you on several levels, that's amusing and entertaining for sure, but that's valuable and teaches us something new for literally pennies, low tech, and that's also important. We had fun doing the study, and we won a very odd award for it. I think I have a new section on my curriculum vita under honors. I have a new section called dubious honors. We were surprised by this award. We received a call that we had we were awarded the 2011 Ig Nobel Prize in Medicine. Apparently, this has been selected. We were selected by a panel of actual Nobel laureates from a field of about 7,000 nominations, and this came out of the blue. Just looking at the surface of our study, what we did, I guess we're not wholly surprised in retrospect. But the purpose of the award, as we understand it, is actually really important. This has been going on for over 20 years. It does get a lot of recognition in the media, and the entire purpose of this award is to excite the public about science, excite mostly children and school-age children about the value of science, and that you can have fun while doing it, that science can be exciting, it can be interesting, it could be quirky, it could be funny, but you could learn from it, and that's really important. My colleagues, Dr. David Darby, a neurologist in Melbourne, and Dr. Robert Feldman, a urologist in Waterbury, Connecticut, who happens to be my father-in-law, were with me to accept the award on behalf of our entire authorship team, which included several of our former students who we're very proud of and have gone on to stellar careers. For my father-in-law, this is fitting punishment for attempting to work with me for a first time on a research project.